Hi, I'm Andrea from AWS.
Hi, I'm Sam from Grindr, and this is my architecture.
Thanks for being here, Sam. So let's dive into this architecture, which focuses on your next gen chat system, which sits on AWS.
Mm-hmm.
What is it?
Well, first of all, Grindr is a dating and connection app for the LGBTQ community. And what's unique about Grindr is that you can initiate a conversation with any of the other users. You don't have to have a match, okay? Mm-hmm. You can just start a conversation. So that leads to a huge amount of chats being generated across our platform. And last year, we actually sent 121 billion chats.
So massive scale.
Massive scale.
Awesome. Let's walk through a user journey. Say I'm a user, I'm using this chat system, and I'm sending a message. What's the first thing that happens?
So you would find the user that you want to talk to in the app. You bring their profile up, their image up, click on the speech bubble, mm-hmm. and then you would send in your chat message. And so what would happen is the form would send a message to our WebSocket layer, okay? And that is the first step in the journey. At this point, the system will then check, you know, you are logged in, you are your credentials. They will check that, you know, the other user hasn't blocked you. So the basic kind of low-level validations will take place at that point.
I see. Elastic Kubernetes service. Mm-hmm. And then where do you run the kind of the brain of the operation? So now you initiate the first contact to AKS. Where's the brain of the operation? It's where you decide upon the different, you know, services that you want to initiate.
So we have a microservice-based architecture. It's all hosted mm-hmm. in EKS. And so once the message arrives at the WebSocket layer, it will then kind of contact these internal services,
okay.
what we call the chat metadata services. And from there, the system will perform further checks and ultimately persist the message.
Fantastic. Now I have the message mm-hmm. that I'm sending. Where do you persist that?
That's a good question, because we actually have two storage systems in mm-hmm. use. We have both Amazon Dynamo and we have Aurora Postgres. And we bifurcate the data between the two. So the chat content, the body of the message, that goes into Dynamo. And then what we call the metadata, so like the headers or the envelope of the messages and the inbox information, that goes into Postgres.
Fantastic. Why did you do that? Why choose both of them?
Yeah, that's another great question. The answer is message data, mm-hmm. the content of the messages will grow very quickly. So we need the kind of huge scale of storage, and that's what Amazon Dynamo will give us. But you also don't read those messages a lot. Once the message is sent to the phone, it kind of stays on the phone unless you change device or move to a different device. But the inbox is constantly changing. Okay, so the metadata, who sent the message last, the ordering of the inbox, the timestamp on the messages, all of that is constantly changing. And so we have a very read-heavy load, this read-heavy load, and this is a write-heavy load. And so that's why we kind of separate the data out.
So you use the best of both, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
With Aurora with read mm-hmm. and then Dynamo for writes. And then say, you know, in this case, when I'm sending my message, I have an inbox, mm-hmm. mentioned inbox. How do you make that inbox readily available so you don't need to go to Aurora every time to read that information?
That's where our ElastiCache comes in, which okay. we're using the Redis version, the Redis flavor of ElastiCache. And so once a user connects, the mm-hmm. phone will connect to this service over REST this time, and then it will come over to, again, the brain of the operation. This system will then come to Redis and say, is that user's inbox available? If it is, it can be served immediately with no load on the database. If it's the first time the user's been online, for a few hours, it will then come over to Aurora. It will refresh the user's entire inbox, populate that back into the Redis cache, and from that moment on, it's kept up to date until the user goes offline.
Fantastic. So a very intelligent way of, you know, being making information readily available for mm-hmm. the user whenever needed. In this architecture, you know, you might have two scenarios, right? Users, the other user being available online versus offline. Is that a decision factor that you had to incorporate into this architecture?
Yeah, so once the message is persisted, which mm-hmm. we've talked about, the system will then come back to the WebSocket layer and say, is the user online? If you're sending me a message, if I'm online, I will also have a WebSocket session, and the system is able to say, let me send that message back out over my WebSocket. So this is your WebSocket,
okay.
W1, this is my WebSocket, W2. If you're not online, you're asleep or you're away from your phone or whatever, the system will determine that there's no WebSocket connection open. We'll then talk to Amazon Pinpoint to send a push notification over the telephony network. Mm-hmm. And so then you will get a pop-up on your phone that says, you know, Sam sent you a message or Andrew sent me a message. And you will typically then open the app to come and see what that message
fantastic,
is.
Fantastic, fantastic. And then let's talk a little bit about security.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what security capabilities do you offer for users using this platform?
So all the message content, which comes into Dynamo, as we mentioned, that's fully encrypted in the application layer, not just at rest. And we use Amazon KMS for that. So this metadata service will encrypt before it comes down. And then inside here, we just have the encrypted bytes. We know that the message ID, so we're able to pull that back. And that's why we can use Dynamo as well, because of the key value store capability.
I see. What about spams and other, you know, attributes that might, you know, infiltrate the system?
Yeah, so protecting our users, we have a bunch of systems that will sit off this that will get the data through our event bus, which we use Kafka for. So this is a managed service for Kafka in AWS. And so every time a message is sent, we'll send the metadata, a metadata event will be sent over to Kafka, at which point we will have a bunch of consumers that sit off the topic and are picking up those events, and then they will do asynchronous operations such as anti-spam or, you know, tracking user connections.
So integration with other systems that this could benefit from. And also the trade-offs. Why did you settle on managed service Kafka and not RabbitMQ or, you know, any other messaging system?
Yeah, great question. RabbitMQ is a great product, but what Kafka gives us is the ability to easily add new consumers and then replay those messages. And so for things like this chat system where we're constantly adding new consumers, we're constantly adding new, you know, spam rules, that kind of thing, it's very easy to add a new consumer, hook it up to the topic, and the producers don't have to care about it. So the producers can just send the message over and over, and then hooking up these extra consumers is completely decoupled.
Fantastic. Sam, thanks so much for walking us through this amazing architecture with your next gen chat system.
It was a pleasure to be here. Thank you.